have your attention and can begin, I think. Hello, small talk. I'm Nick Papoulias, and I will be presenting today my work, my PhD. We'll be talking about reflection, and specifically reflection with mirrors. I'm working with these guys. You probably know them. It's Steph, Marcus, Nuri, and Luke. And I will begin by explaining our motivation about reflection. So, my field of expertise is programming language and tools. And in my PhD, I have a specific interest on robotics and embedded devices. So, what I would like to have in terms of reflection? I would like to have a reflection subsystem that is pluggable. That means that if I have 1,000 robotics out there, I want to be able to deploy my reflective subsystem, program them, run my process, my debuggers, my inspectors, and then when it is time to actually make the robots do their thing, deploy them, in the time of deployment, after programming, I want to be able to take the reflective subsystem out, because in that way we can save resources, we can actually refine things as security, and have a specific object-oriented design for doing remote programming. And why is that? Because if we kind of think of what our programming tools are, what is a browser or what is a debugger, there are tools that are actually reflecting on the base system of the language. The browser reflects structurally on the base system of a language. The debugger reflects on the executional part of a language. So if we have reflection as a pluggable subsystem, we actually have a model of our language upon which we can build our tools and actually do remote programming. So, we began and said, okay, we want to have this pluggable reflection subsystem. The parts would be there, we will take them and mix them, and it will all be fine. But there are some problems with reflection. First of all, there is no such thing as a reflective subsystem in object-oriented languages. There is no object-oriented design for reflection itself. In all high-level and object-oriented reflective languages, actually, reflection is scattered functionality across the language. And I will give you some examples of that. This means that there is mixed base and meta-level functionality. So, since I spoke about examples, the same base-level object, a car, that responds to methods such as the number of doors in the car, is the same object that actually responds to meta-level questions, to meta-level functionality. We can ask the car for the number of doors, but it's the same car who will respond to us about its class, or we can send to it instbarat or instbarat put and things like that, and do reflection with the same object. So, without any way of controlling the jump from the base to the meta level, from one line to another, we went from one level to another. And why this can be a problem? Imagine that we would like to do security, so we would like to have another implementation of reflection, one that does not allow us to change the state of an object. How could we do that, since there is no encapsulation of reflection, since there is not a specific design pattern of reflection? Other problems, some actually known problems in meta-object protocols and reflection, is the fact that reflection itself breaks encapsulation. What does this mean? Imagine that I am an author of a software library, and I'm writing this software library, and I am giving it to software developers to use it. And they use it
as part of an object-oriented language.
So, since they are using object orientation, they think that they have encapsulation in their system. But if I am using reflection inside my library, no one can guarantee to the developer that his objects are actually encapsulated. Reflection breaks encapsulation, and that actually may lead to software bugs for software engineers using our libraries. But this is not so so new. And what happens is that in 2004, Praha and Duga comes along and say, okay, we have to do something about all these problems with reflection. So what they proposed in a sentence is mirrors. They said, okay, we will have these objects, simple objects, where we will migrate all our reflection methods. So that's why they call it functional decomposition of reflection. So they took the language, the base system of the language, and the meta level where reflective functionality was scattered across different entities, and they put all these functions into object entities called mirrors. And with mirrors, you can have properties as encapsulation. That means that the reflective functionality of every object in the language is encapsulated, so you can have multiple implementation through encapsulation. You can have stratification, which in terms of resources, what does it mean? It means that when you don't use reflection, you can discard it altogether. You can discard all this reflective functionality. And one other property that is wishful thinking for those who are implementing mirrors is ontological correspondence, which means that for every entity in your language, you should have a correspondent mirror. So, this will be the same example in Smalltalk with a car if we were using mirrors. So, you see the difference is that when I am actually jumping from the base level to the meta level, I do that by invoking the mirror on the object. And what good can this do me is that actually behind this I can have multiple implementations, or I can actually forbid the user or the developer to use reflection and discard reflection altogether. So, we said for doing pluggable reflection, mirrors seems a nice idea. But there is a catch here. Reflection and with mirrors was actually applied as an ad hoc solution to programming language that we have today. So, in order to separate the base from the meta, we just migrated the functionality, the methods. But the functionality of reflection actually works on top of meta information, of the model of your language. So, what about meta information? Can we actually separate the meta information too from the base level? This is the question that we asked ourselves. And a quick example about both functional and structural decomposition of reflection from Smalltalk. So, a student comes to you, or even worse, your girlfriend or your wife, and asks, okay, what is base and what is meta in Smalltalk? So you start with a point, which should be a base level entity, but as we saw, it also responds to meta level messages like class and things like that, which actually means in terms of meta information that the object is accessing the object, its object representation in Smalltalk. It goes below the language level, to the VM level, to the object representation through a primitive, and accesses meta information about itself. So yes, it's a base level entity that does some, that has some meta level functionality. It can do reflection, it can reflect on itself. What about the class? Actually, the class can respond to some base level functionality. We put methods in the class, okay, to use them for all our objects. Okay, since it responds to base level functionality, it must be a base level entity. But
Actually, it also holds meta information about its objects, about itself. It also responds to reflective methods, so it's still both. So the instance is both, the class is both. What about the meta class? The meta class must be a meta level functionality, a meta level entity. Well, it turns out that the base level methods that the class responds to are stored in the meta class. So we have this ambiguity there too. And this, as we said, has an impact on encapsulation. If we need to have multiple implementation of reflection, on stratification, if we want to discard reflection altogether, and this actually makes a difference in terms of resources and security. But is this a bad thing, that there is this ambiguity of the base and the meta level in Smalltalk? No. This is actually the power of Smalltalk. The ability to go from one statement to the other and make this jump from the base to the meta level. But with great power comes great responsibility. That's why at every step we can freeze and break our images. That's why security is an issue when you have such a powerful language. So actually, with great power comes great responsibility. Since I am studying in France, it's from Voltaire, not Spider-Man, but okay. So, what is our goal? Our goal actually is to decompose the base from the meta level altogether, both functionally and structurally. And currently in Smalltalk, you cannot, for example, discard the reflective functionality or the metadata. In classic mirror-based systems, for example, in StrongTalk or in NewSpeak, you can discard the reflective functionality, since mirrors, classical mirrors do only functional decomposition. Our goal is to improve mirrors to also have structural decomposition, so you can discard metadata. So at the end, what we want to give you is all the power of reflection with none of the responsibilities, when you choose to, of course. So we wanted to experiment with this idea. So what we said is that we want to have a base level that can actually run independently. That means a language that can live without reflection at all. And you will have a meta level, and every base level entity will have a mirror, a meta level entity that reflects on this base level object. And every reflective method and every meta information will be stored in mirrors, so both functional and structural decomposition. And one thing that we have to pay attention to is that all other entities, even meta classes, who will probably, well, you will probably want to have some reflective functionality, will provide this reflective functionality explicitly through mirrors. So whoever uses reflection, he will use it through mirrors. Whenever you have meta information, a language meta information in your system, it will be stored in mirrors. And even dynamic addition of behavior can only be done through mirrors. So with this object model, we built a prototype because we wanted to test this idea, and this idea is a theoretical limit for us for the decomposition between base and meta to answer this actual question. So we built MetaTalk, which actually is a whole system built on far from the virtual machine to the compiler to the object model. And with MetaTalk, what we have validated is this. We have validated the sample execution of base level functionality when you have mirrors. When you don't have mirrors, the sample execution of the meta level, when of course you have mirrors or you add functionality or you do introspection and things like that. And we have validated that when you discard your meta level altogether, you still have your base level functionality. So we actually validated that we are in the right way for a pluggable reflection subsystem with complete decomposition between the base and the meta levels. So related work, as we've already said, is Braha and Durgar from 2004. Lawrence and Lissidis have some work on pluggable reflection, which is pluggable reflection actually outside the language. They don't concern themselves with the meta level inside the language, but how to provide pluggable reflection by having an outside tool actually generating meta information for you when you have your reflective subsystem inside the language. The declarative model for Smalltalk can be considered related work because someone could use the declarative model for Smalltalk to build a Smalltalk that does not have reflection, but then you wouldn't have this pluggability property. Resilient, of course, which tries to minimize resources in terms of programming robotics and embedded devices. And then in terms of mirrors and intercession and behavioral reflection, there is the work from Formiraz and Abrinbok, which we want to address some of the issues raised there in the future. So yes, our future work is metrics in terms of resources. How many resources can you save by when you do stratification, for example? And don't think that meta information in programming languages is just the class and the superclass. It's the abstract syntax trees. It's versioning information, it's organizational information for your classes, profiling information and source code and a lot of other things. We want to see how mirrors play in the context of behavioral reflection and have some case studies for remote programming. So thank you very much. And when you have the mirrors on, you can add new behavior and do introspection and self-modification on your objects. So
what about the class message, for example, which...
The
class message, which is clearly a meta message, but it's also necessary for the VM to work.
Yes. We explained this in the paper. So in terms of meta information, you have to divide meta information to low level meta information that the virtual machine needs and to high level meta information that your language actually uses. And what we've done there is that the low level meta information that we use is all in the object header and is not accessible by the language, as in that is Smalltalk. Smalltalk actually goes inside the object representation and asks for meta information. So we actually decompose the language from the virtual machine because the meta information that the language uses is not retrieved from the object header, and we have some preliminary metrics on this. And if you have a 64-bit object header, as for example Gemstorm has, you can have all your low-level meta information stored there, so it's not that much, and all other meta information will be in the meta level for you to discard. And one more thing is that your meta information this way will be extensible, because when you want to add new meta information to your object, you will just add it to your mirror. I don't know if I covered you.
No, thank you.